If not, okay, he's telling me to shut up. I am so excited to be with you guys. If I haven't had the chance to meet you, I was gone a lot in December. I am grateful to be back. My name's John. I serve as pastor here at the Springs. We're going to start by reading a section of scripture out of the book of Philippians. If you've been with us, we're working our way through Matthew, but we are taking off today. We're going to do kind of a standalone talk. We're going to look at the book of Philippians, chapter 4. If you want to turn there, if not, watching on home, it'll be at the bottom of the screen or it'll be behind me. Verses 10 through 13, chapter 4. The Apostle Paul writing in a letter to a church in Philippi. It's a heart of gratitude. He's saying, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I'm speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound in any and every circumstance. I've learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Well, I'm really glad y'all are here. Just pray with me. Father, I thank you for the gift of your people, of your word, of the chance to gather. Lord, I'm asking that you'd come and you'd do what only you can do, and that's change hearts. Change hearts here for those of us gathered in person. Change hearts online for those watching for the first time or tuning in, or just families at home. Make us one people. Unite us across it all. Would you help us to leave here more in love with you? For those who've come, God, perhaps for the first time back to church or a resolution and they feel distanced, they feel unworthy, would you just soften that heart? Would you slow it down? Let them know they are welcome, that you have looked forward to it and you love them and you're so glad they're here as we are. One of the things, if you're with us, I used to do more often, and there was no reason I stopped, but in the middle of prayer, I'd ask for you guys at home in person to pray for me. If y'all would, please take 10 seconds and say just a prayer to yourself, right? That God would use this time and that I would be helpful to his people. It sure is a privilege being a follower of yours, Jesus. I pray that that extend to every person this morning. It's in your name we're asking for your help. And we love knowing that you appreciate and you get excited to give it. Amen. Well, really am so glad to be here. One of the things that's true that I imagine if you guys felt this, it's a new year, right? Anyone else have neighbors, right? I've had the privilege of living in New Braunfels coming on now 4 years. I've done New Year's here every time. I have never once been woken up by my, like, close neighbors in the middle of the night on New Year's Eve at midnight with fireworks and people celebrating outside, but I did this year. Anybody send off fireworks for the first time? Maybe a little pyrotechnic people, teenagers, something like that. Maybe you guys online, right? There was an excitement about New Year's this year. Right? Because if I were to come and talk to you, here's an obvious realization that for many of us, it's just overplayed. 2020, what a year. What a year. I found myself in December, my family, we have one of those kind of Christmas countdown calendars where you pull something out. We have a daughter, she's almost 4, a little boy, he doesn't understand it. But you pull out these things and you're counting down. It's like a nativity countdown clock to Christmas Day. Now, I've been doing that with them and even before that in the month of December for a long time, but this December, I found myself with 2 countdowns. That nativity countdown, but then a second countdown, and this is a countdown, honestly, I've never really had before. It was a countdown to 2021. Why? For some reason, sometime, right in the beginning of December, there was a sense in me that just kind of broke of, I'm over 2020. Now, for some of you, that may have happened in February or March or April. That may have been when it turned for you. But for me, honestly, it turned in December. My Christmas plans, family was going to gather. That whole thing changed, right? I would end up going through the month, and I'm just sitting there. I'm saying, man, I'm done with 2020. I'm looking forward to 2021. Anybody else feel that? Anybody else legitimately excited? Because if you're saying that you weren't, you're a liar. The good news is the church is for liars. Jesus has help. But we all felt that. It's funny, even too, if you watch commercials or TV or YouTube or whatever, advertisers picked up on this. They showed commercials and videos that played on 2020 and then pulled a heartstring to 2021. There's a lot of ones. There was one in particular, right? It was actually done by Match.com. Some of you, you guys may have seen it, right? I'm going to show it. It's just a one-minute clip. And what it pulls on is a difference between 2020 2021. And now I'm guessing most of you know this Match.com online dating. Now there is a thing, if you're at home and you're a parent and you got littles with you, I do want to give a bit of a disclaimer. Welcome back to the Springs. Disclaimer is this. It starts with a caricature of Satan, right? Now we'll break it down. We'll talk about Satan. But I do want to give you a heads up. Like I know my kids, hi Lily. I know they're watching at home, right? If you don't want them to see this, feel free, pause it, or you can use this as your excuse for, I knew we shouldn't have gone back to church in the new year. Whatever you want to use it as, but there's your disclaimer. So take the next minute and watch this commercial about the difference in 2020 and the hope of 2021. We'll put it up on the screen.
Hi. 2020.
Please. Call me 2020. So where are you from?
Hell.
Me too.
Call me or save me. I've been feeling so alone. I keep waiting for you, but you never come. Is this in my head? I don't know what to do.
This year to end.
Who would?
Now I need to give another disclaimer, okay? That commercial, there were two options. One was a minute, and the other was a minute and a half long. I intentionally found the minute one because there was a football scene that had an acronym, right? And that acronym, some of you may have caught it, it was excluded in one, and I have no idea how that one just got up there, right? So on behalf of that, families at home or people here, I do sincerely apologize for that. But it's just a good example of 2020, the gift that keeps tragically on giving. It's this silly thing, right? Where even advertisers, they picked up on it. What was, but what could be in the hope of 2021. I don't know, in my lifetime certainly, I imagine most of yours, there's never been a year that had more hope or expectation riding on it. You want to talk about pressure, 2021 has pressure, but it's because we all found ourselves disliking, and understandably so, 2020. I really felt that in December. There really was an honest sense, and I said it multiple times, I can't wait for 2021. Now, if you're here and you're a follower of Jesus Christ, here's something that you might know. Something happened to me that I bet it's happened to you before. Is I'm feeling this sense of I want out of this and into that, that what I need is 2021. I gotta change this. Hope awaits. I got that like tapping on the heart of the Spirit of God. And it just whispered this. He just said to me, you should not need 2021. Not audibly, but just kind of like I felt that. You should not need 2021. With that as our backdrop, here's what I want to share with you, folks online, folks here in person. I want to talk about something that it may seem a little controversial at the top, but I'm going to break it out. Here's what I want to talk about. 2020 was an amazing year. 2020 was an amazing year. I want to show you how if you're here, and specifically I'm talking to those of us who would consider ourselves disciples of Christ, followers of Jesus, believers in him, how we can come and with integrity actually say that and mean that. We may have to work to get there, and that's okay. But you can come, and what I want to do in your heart is what God has been doing in my heart, with integrity say, 2020 2020 was an amazing year, and here's how we're going to do it. We're going to look at the Apostle Paul. He has this biblical lens through which he sees the world, a worldview. So we're even in the midst of trial, even in the midst of struggle, even in the midst of absolute tragedy, fear, and worry, he can say with actual integrity, I have found the secret to contentment. What if you and I take the same lens that he uses there and we look back on 2020? What if by the Spirit of God we could come and we could say, with its pain, with its hardship, with its tragedy, and it had those, 2020 was an amazing year. Now, as we go to do this, I do want to put up front, 2020 had tremendous hardship. I'm also not acting as if that hardship is just gone or it won't come into 2021. There are people here. You lost family members that you did not expect to lose in 2020. You wanted to go to funerals, but you perhaps weren't even allowed to attend the funeral. You wanted to go to the bedside in the hospital, but you perhaps were not even allowed entrance. Or it was just one family member and not others. There's real hardship. I am not taking away from that. Some of you, even a family member was there. This was a Christmas where you've always spent it with family or around people, but for fear you didn't, and you had to figure out how to get a FaceTime going on Christmas morning to connect family, and on the inside you resented it because it's just not the same, because it isn't. There's real hardship. Some of you, 2020, you lost your job. It was the first year you filed for unemployment, the first time where you came to Christmas and you looked at presents and what you normally have the privilege of being a part of, and you had to communicate to family, hey guys, this year, the Spirit is there. We're going to make it about Jesus. But hey, we're just going to do white elephant. We're not going to do the gift exchange part. That's real. The financial insecurity, the fear, the worry about your physical health. Some of you, you're at home right now with COVID or some other disease. Some of you, you've had the moment where you've had to wrestle with, if you got COVID or you got something else, a real sense of your own mortality and the reality, death is coming. As we go to talk about a biblical lens that by the power of God's Spirit you could see 2020 through, if you're a follower of Christ, and be able to say it was an amazing year. I absolutely recognize it's hard, tragic, excruciating, loss, pain. There were family members you wished were around the Christmas table, and they weren't there. Friends you wish you could see, financial hope, whatever it might be, it was a hard year. But how could we, in the midst of that, find this language that Paul uses, the secret of contentment? That is what I want for me. That is what the Holy Spirit began tapping on my soul, and that is what I pray, if you're here and you believe in Jesus, he does with you. Now, if you don't believe in Jesus, here's what I hope you see by this. If you're back to church or you're checking it out or you've been coming a while and you're wrestling, if you don't believe in Jesus, here's what you're going to see. Christians, we have faith in someone that we love and we think changes everything. That's the only reason we're able to say this statement. It's not out of callousness. It's not out of foolishness. It's out of faith. So my prayer for you as you see this is not to make this statement that 2020 was an amazing year, but to try to understand, who would they believe in to where they could put such faith, such trust, such commitment, such confidence, they could even make the statement? That will make 2021 an amazing year if you realize that. We're going to be in Philippians chapter 4. I've missed y'all. We're in verses 10 through 13. We're going to take Paul's worldview, this biblical lens that he views, trial and tragedy and worldview. It's a big word. I'm using it in a very specific sense today. Literally, a view through which he sees the world. We're going to talk about how 2020 was an amazing year, and we are going to fight to get our hearts there. We're going to break it down into three things. There were three truths that Paul exemplifies through this for those at home, those here. There's three truths he wants you and me to hear so that we could say this and mean it. The first, trust in God, not circumstances. The second, no contentment is learned. Third, realize your only hope is Christ. That's it. That's what makes 2020 an amazing year. D- To give you a little context, and again, you can turn to Philippians 4 at home or in person. Again, we'll put it up here. You can pull it up on your phone, whatever you want to do. The church in Philippi, that's who Paul, big-time church leader, is writing this letter to. It was a church he'd actually started, founded, planted. 10 years has gone by. In that 10 years, Paul, this church leader, this missionary, this teacher, he's now in prison. He's in a Roman prison. Why? For his faith. He's waiting to find out whether he will live or whether he will die. He's likely chained to a wall in a Roman guard there. He's in extreme hardship, extreme trouble, extreme trial. Will I live? Will I die? And he has, it's an amazing book. You can go back, 2019, we taught through it. I didn't get the privilege of teaching this passage. My buddy Garrison, who's on staff, he taught it. He did an excellent job. You can go back and listen to it. But I just wanted the chance to come and teach it too. Because Paul shows this amazing thing of faith. And sometimes you and I, when we read our Bible, we commit a fallacy. Right? If you have the Spirit of God in you, and if you believe in Jesus, you do. We commit a fallacy where we think, well, hey, I can't be connected to God the way they were connected to God. It's just different. I can't have that kind of faith the way that they had faith. It's just different. No, 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 no. Spirit of God in him, Spirit of God in you, Spirit of God in me. I want the secret to contentment. And he shows it. So that's what we're going to see. That's the context of where we are. I'm going to read verses 10 through 13 again, and then we're going to kind of jump through the three different ways that Paul gives us this lens to read it so that you and I, with integrity, could say 2020 was an amazing year. Paul starts, I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. If you're at home just reading your Bible, you should always read it thoughtfully, critically, sincerely. You should read that and like literally in the side be like, how is that possible? I want that. God loves that. That's what we're after. I know how to be brought low and I know how to abound. You see the roller coaster Paul's going on through his life. I know how to be brought low and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all through him who strengthens me. If that's true, and you're a follower of Jesus Christ, through that same faith lens, you could say something as controversial, as crazy, or maybe even as silly, as 2020 was an amazing year. Here's how. There's three things that Paul, he understands. There's three lenses. There's more than that, but I want to share with you three. The first lens that Paul is really exemplifying, he's modeling, that you and I can cling to look redemptively on the past and redemptively on the future and be content in the present. First way he does it is there's this exclamation point on this theme, trust in God, not circumstances. Trust in God, not circumstances. Here's what I'm saying. You have to recognize that if you believe in Jesus, you believe in the creator of the heavens and the earth. He spoke it into existence. He maintains it by his power. There is nothing that falls outside of his grasp. He is sovereign. That means he's never surprised. 2020 didn't come, and God and Christ and the Spirit and the power of the Trinity all of a sudden come and say, oh man, I did not see this coming. What should we do? Fauci, you should have been on it, man. That wasn't in him. He was over it. He was in control of it. You know what that also means, church? He allowed it. He permitted it. He decreed it. Trust in God. Not circumstances. Let me show you how Paul does this. He uses this in his own life in a few ways, how he trusts in God. The first is this exemplified in his relationship to the church there in Philippi. What was true? He planted that church. 10 years has gone by. You hear it from the text. He hasn't been in touch with them. They haven't supported him. And now all of a sudden, what happens to this church? They revived in verse 10. their concern for Paul. The word revive, it's beautiful in the Greek. It's literally the language of like a flower that was closed, blossoming. God has revived and reignited the heart of this church to care for the one that they always loved. They always cared about Paul, but to now care in an action. You see, Paul, Roman prison's different than ours, right? Our prison system, with all of its flaws, right? It's state-sponsored. Your tax dollars fund it. When you go to jail or to prison, you do not have to fundraise for your dinner. Paul had to fundraise. Paul had to self-support. He hadn't reached out to Philippi. God had just stirred their hearts to care for him. Paul trusts in the sovereign reality that he's in there because of God, and God is caring for him as he's there. You see it in his attitude as he's even writing these people. The second way you see it is Paul's language. Look, the way Paul starts his language in verse 12, maybe 11. He says, I know how to be brought low. Your translation, it may say, to live humbly with nothing. It carries a connotation, if you are brought somewhere, you are led by someone. Who led Paul to being brought low? To sitting in the cell, wondering life or death. The same creator of the universe, the same one that forgave him of his sins and removed the scales from his eyes as he spoke to him on the road to Damascus, the same one that transformed your heart, the same one that pleads with you, I love you. Apart from me, you can do nothing. You are in desperate need of me. You don't have to work your way to me. I came down to you. I died for you because I love you. Believe. And let's go. That's who. That same God brought him low, allowed it, sovereign over it. Trust in God. He's in control. The second thing Paul's saying is not in circumstances. You see this in language where he says, I know how to be brought low. I know how to abound. I know how to have plenty. I know how to have hunger. I know how to have abundance, and I know how to have need. He's talking in general the roller coaster ride of his life. He's referencing every situation, every circumstance, a full belly and a starving belly, money to do what I need to do and desperately needing money with no place to lay my head, health, sickness, comfort, beatings, freedom, prison. You name the situation. That wasn't where Paul was placing his hope. It wasn't where he was placing his well-being. It wasn't where he was placing his contentment. Why? He's placing it in God. You see, if you're trusting in God, it does something. One of the reasons why 2020 was hard for me is because I had expectations. I had things that I wanted. I had put hope. I had put a sense of control in my circumstance, my situations. Being able to go see a movie in a movie theater, that was gone. That bothered me. I had placed this sense of really my well-being and how things were going around me. Paul is saying, man, you can't find hope in right? Your financial reality. You can't find hope in whether your political person won or lost. Don't put your hope there. You can't find hope and even the relationships, because some of you, whether married or single, you felt the absence of relationship and wanting to be with people you couldn't, and it crippled you. To then you had to live with people that you committed to and you loved, and it crippled you, and come and talk to us. We will disciple you through that. But do you see, Paul's not putting his hope when things abound. He's not putting his hope in the plenty. He's not putting his hope in the wellness. It's not in the situation. It's not in the circumstance. His trust is in God. What if you and I looked back on 2020 and we did a bit of an audit and then we were honest? Because you went through what I went through. I was absolutely guilty of this. The emotional roller coaster of the year with its highs and its lows, which with its downfalls and its beautiful aspects. And we did an audit and we said, where did you place your hope? Where did you place that real sense of trust? Not just in its right to be a responsible adult. That's not what I'm talking about. Of course that's true. But where did you find your sense of well-being that when it was gone, it took from you far more than what it should? Where did you try to find comfort, security, expectation in things outside of God? It's like anchoring yourself, except the anchor floats with the tide. It's crazy. One of the ways that I can still do this in my own life, or I talk with people, right? There's a new conversation. It's an extremely controversial one. And it has to do with a word that used to be so normal, right? So used all the time. And here's what it was. Normal. I don't know if you found yourself in this conversation yet. I imagine many of you have. If not, you will, and welcome to it. Here's the controversial conversation. People just need to get on board and embrace the new normal. Normal. Other side. I won't embrace the new normal. I'm going back. My kid's going back to school, and I'm not wearing a mask for the rest of my life. New normal? Get on the train. Old normal? You can't change everything. I'm still shaking people's hands. Right? Some of y'all? Maybe? Okay. Here's the thing, guys. Hope is not placed. Trust, contentment, well-being. Am I saying you can't have a desire for one or the other? No, I'm not saying that. But what I'm absolutely saying is if your well-being, your hope, your trust is too anchored, overplaced, wrongly put in either a return to the old or everyone finally embracing the new, you're missing it. What Christ is wanting to create in you is an internal new normal, always a new normal that is anchored on Him, not in the situation, not in the circumstance, not what happens in 2021, not in what happens and how quickly you could get a rollout of a vaccine, right? Or the right person comes into the party, or the economy stays there, or the housing market doesn't collapse, or you get the job back. It's not in that. In Him, He creates the new normal. Do you see Paul? He's sitting in a prison cell wondering whether or not he'll die, and he says, I found the secret to contentment. The primary lens, well, not primary, a wonderful lens he's seeing that through is trust in God, not circumstance. What's a second way he does this? What's a second key to unlocking the secret of contentment? If you and I, if you're a follower of Jesus, you want to come and with integrity look back and say 2020 was an amazing year, through a redemptive lens, not through a foolish lens, not through an ignorant lens, not by just looking past the negative, through an honest one. If the first way is you trust in God, not circumstances, the second thing that Paul, he's really modeling here is a principle. It's a principle that I find great comfort in. That's this. No contentment is learned. No contentment is learned. This is the second thing that unlocks the sense of a secret to contentment. It's this. If you don't totally have it, it's okay. There's a process to this. Let's start by defining the word contentment, and then I want to define learned. Contentment here, it means contentment. It's fascinating, though. It means satisfied with your current condition. Paul, he starts, even in this letter, they've sent him these gifts, this financial support that he needed to sustain himself. And he's saying to them, thank you. He's got great etiquette. But he's also saying, but I didn't need it. I was good. Thank you. But I didn't need it. They had a sense of satisfaction and well-being, as we'll see in a moment, steadfastness. The second thing that this really speaks to is the word learned. See, you might read the word learned and think like, oh man, Paul, he just had like some supernatural epiphany. There was just this moment, this blinding light in the jail cell where the Holy Spirit came, or maybe an angel spoke it and just said to him, hey, Paul, here is what you need to know, this epiphany, this paradigm shift. It's not this word. That word exists in the Greek. That's not this word. This word, knowledge over time. Paul is saying he grew in contentment through experience. It took him time. He got better at it as he grew in his faith. It's this promise for you and me as you and I fight to to look back on 2020 and say it was an amazing year, it's okay if you have to like start and fight for that. But here's what's true. Who knows what happens 2021? Who knows what happens 2022? Who knows what happens 2030? What God is pleading for in you and in me, and that Paul's going to model, is he's going to say, hey, you take every trial over time, you take every trial over time, and you learn. You grow. You become more like him. And here's what 2020 gave you plenty of, gave me plenty of. Opportunity to get better. Trial. Testing. A producing within you. Contentment. Do you know who is responsible for my contentment? My well-being, my sense of joy, my faithfulness? Do you know who's responsible for that? Me. You know who wants to help me? Who literally says, for those who love my name, I will help you. He delights in it. You know who wants to help me? God. He wants that to grow in you, to grow in me. You got to know, though, it is a process, and it can be learned. So with that mindset, as we're thinking about 2020 in a redemptive lens where you could see it as an amazing year only but for the grace of God, let me ask you, what did you learn? If experience and time and trial is meant to be a tutor, a teacher, I'd ask you, what did you learn? A friend of Paul's, the half-brother of Jesus, his name's James. You don't have to turn there. But he even says, let trials and difficulty produce in you a steadfastness. You know what that is? Synonym of contentment. That you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. So what if you and I look back on 2020 and we honestly said, what did I learn? What did the trial, the difficulty, teach me? Maybe it learned, like if you're here, and perhaps you're in college, or really any life stage, you learn that you're always looking forward to the next season of life. Like, you might not remember this, but right, if you're in high school, all you want to do is you want to go to college. If you're in college, all you want to do is get out of college. Well, some of y'all, you should, right? You should get out of college, and then, oh, I'll finally be happy if I get the career, and then I'll finally be happy if I can get the spouse, and then the kid, and then the job, and then the status, and then you go through life, and guess what? You're still not content. Maybe 2020 showed you. It exposed a truth in you that you really define your singleness as being alone. That's the opposite of the way God defines it. Where in a moment where you really realized you had free time and you actually connected with God, you met with him in his word, you disciplined yourself to pray, you bent your knee to bow, and it brought beauty. Maybe you learned that. Maybe you learn that he wants intimacy with you. He doesn't hold himself back. He pursues. Maybe you learned that you chase status and significance through work, through your job, through the career, through what other people think of you. And honestly, you're just exhausted. The book of Ecclesiastes describes it as chasing after wind. Something I learned. Better is a handful of quietness than two hands full of toil and striving after wind. Maybe you learned that you need to invest in your marriage, that being roommates, it's just not worth it. Like, yeah, maybe you could even get away with it till the kids go out, but it's not worth it. It's not what God wants for you. Maybe you learned that you place far more sense of security and comfort in situation and circumstance. What did 2020 teach you? What did you learn? How did you grow? God meant to use it to grow you. Has it? Let's look at the third thing. Let's jump into verse 13 right here, Philippians chapter 4. The third thing, the truth that Paul grants you and me, this lens that we can look back on 2020 and see it as an amazing year. The first, again, it's trust in God, not circumstance. The second is know that contentment's learned. How did you grow? What did God develop? How did you learn? How are you more like him? Because 2020 gave you plenty of opportunity. Did you waste some of it? I did. By his grace, I didn't waste all of it. But I wasted some of it. But what's the third? How have you and I come to realize your only hope is Christ? Now, if you don't know Jesus Christ, this is really the heart that I hope you get. But if you do know Jesus Christ, I don't mean this only salvifically, heaven and hell. I mean this as the number one priority in your life if you want the well-being, the happiness, the mindfulness, the joy, the peace, the patience, the gentleness, the kindness, the comfort, the security, all of that. That sense of being a person that when others get around them, they just want to be like, which is glorifying to God. He wants to use you in that way. Did you realize your only hope is Christ? Like, your number one shot at your best life ever. It's not by doing what you want. It is by getting to know the creator of the universe that died on the cross, rose from the grave, granted you his spirit, and is coming for you again. That's it. You get a glimpse of this in verse 13. It's the verse that's wrongly applied. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, Paul says this, in light of situation, in light of circumstance, how can he have this secret contentment? I can do all things through him who strengthens me, a.k.a. Tim Tebow verse, right? You may have seen this in a weight room where people think wrongly, oh man, this just means I could lift this weight, I could do this thing, I could accomplish this goal, or with Christ on my side, I am more than a conqueror. He's the conqueror. He'll help you. But guess what? Read it in context. Paul's in prison. He might die. Doesn't guarantee it always goes well, but it guarantees with him it's always worth it. You see that in two ways. This verse, it's kind of showing two things. First, it's saying, where does the ability to look at 2020 redemptively even come from? Where's that strength? It's through God. It's through Christ. It's talking about the origin or the source of your ability to even move into 2021. And legitimately end the year more in love with Jesus in a way to where people can tell and you don't even have to fake it because it's real. It's his strength. It's the indwelling power of God's Spirit. And he totally wants it for you. He desperately wants it for me. But the second thing that Paul, he's tipping his hat to here, it's something that really the entire theme of Philippians teaches. It's this idea that not only is his strength through Christ, but Christ is his strength. It's not just through, it is in, that he is his number one desire. Do you know what Paul legitimately loved more than anyone or anything? Jesus Christ. And it was real. It was totally real. Like worship for him, there was a real sense. It doesn't mean that he was just led by his feelings, that there was never a dry moment, but the number one desire, hope, commitment was Jesus. He went on not circumstance, not situation, a person, a relationship. He says it, Philippians chapter 3, it's a famous verse. It's just one of the most convicting in the Bible. It's worth reading. Indeed, this is Paul talking about his relationship with Jesus, the one that he has gone all in on. And some of you, you've come back this year, and I'm absolutely telling you, your discomfort, your pain, the absence of your happiness, your peacefulness, your inability to sleep well at night, the absence of well-being, however you want to describe it, it will change. If you realize Christ is your hope, hope has a name, peace has a name, comfort has a name, and it's Jesus. Here's the way Paul describes his hope, his peace, his comfort, his strength. Philippians 3:8, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. Did you? I'll read it again. I count everything as loss. Because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for his sake, I've suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish. Politely said, that at best means trash. In order what? That I might gain Christ. He's not talking about just going to heaven. He's talking about the intimacy from one degree of glory to another, more like him, less like the broken version of me. Third way you and I can look back on 2020 and see it redemptively by the power of God. It can be an amazing year if you allow it to teach you, if you allow it to tutor you, that your only hope is Christ. It's not your marriage. Marriages should be great. If you're a follower of Christ, it should be the glory and a picture of the gospel. Your spouse is a terrible God. Stop trying to make him one. The one who's going to bring you comfort and peace, his name is Jesus. It is not in the financial security. It is not in your physical well-being. Paul's waiting to die and he's singing in prison. It's in him. Like what if, like watching at home and us here, our reputation, the way you became known, the way I became known, it was just for this. They love Jesus more than anything. They're imperfect. They mess it up. They have to repent. They sin. They can be hypocritical. They can lose their temper. They have bad attitudes. They can be stubborn, narrow-minded, foolish. But they love Jesus more than anything. Y'all, here's what I'm telling you. 2020 reminded me, and I've known this, man, I've taught this. That is my only hope. My hope has a name. Your hope has a name. Your strength has a name. Your comfort, your security. It's Jesus. 2020, through this lens, if you're a follower of Christ, was an amazing year. Why? It at best introduced or began to put you down the path of trusting in God, not circumstance. You know what you're going to be tempted to do in 2021? And I'm not even saying it's all wrong. I, of course, have hopes and expectations for how things will turn out in 2021. Like, it would be great to see people online again because there's a sense of safety, like Rose to come back. I'm all for that. But is that going to be where I overplace my hope, my well-being, my trust? Nope, it's going in Christ. In God, not circumstance. The second thing is you got to know this is learned. Are you allowing God to teach you? Are you allowing God to grow you? Like in my garage, because this past year it was challenging. I'll tell you about that in a moment. I literally just wrote on the wall, I am changing. Guess who gets the credit, though? Not me. I guarantee you that. God's helping me become more like him. I am more aware of my sin, more imperfect, more broken. I'm legitimately, by his grace and his grace alone, not because of anything good in me. I love Jesus more now. I appreciate him more. I got a wake-up call. 2020 was an amazing year. Have you learned any of that? Even if you're fighting to take a step, he's teaching you that. Third thing, I'm just pleading. And so you know I'm pleading with me. Your only hope is Jesus. That's it. So here's what I want to ask you guys to do. One simple thing. I want to ask you to do it today if you can, but if you can't, I understand. You can do this alone, or you can do it at lunch, you can do it with friends, you can do it with family, but you got to do it with people that you trust. And you got to do it with people, if you're a follower of Christ, who get it. And I want you, by the power of God, to look back redemptively on 2020. And I want you to just write it out, talk it out, and start with the hard. Start with it. They're not here anymore. I'm still pleading for a job. No one else seemed to care like a stimulus check was coming, but I needed that check. You put whatever. And then you ask before God, God, what are you trying to teach me? What do you want to show me? And if you'll yield to his spirit, I imagine you're going to get some themes. A trusting in him, not circumstances. I imagine you get some themes of hardship was a tutor. Well, it may be more pain, and you may not even laugh as much as you used to, but there is perhaps a sense of health in you, or you're totally marked by dishealth, but now you have a path out because a different way to look at it. And I bet it boils up to a promise or to a sense, you and I, our only hope, our only joy, our only comfort, only security, and I do mean only. I'm not saying you can't find it in other things, but I'm just saying they make terrible gods. Trust me, I've tried. Your only hope for 2021 and beyond is Christ. Period. Christ. Period. See, you and I, we have a tendency to take the name of Christ and tag things on. Christ, and I get that next job. And no one in my family gets sick, and I don't have to attend any funerals, and my political party wins, and I get the outcome that I want, and things go back to my version of normal, and my spouse finally turns around. No, stop. Christ, period. I got that mixed up in 2020. I've gotten that mixed up long before 2020. I'll get it mixed up 2021. But by the Spirit of God, my hope, what I'm pleading your hope is Christ, period. That starts, if you don't know him, by believing he extends you forgiveness for your sins. That the only thing you need to do to receive that is believe. Believe he died for it. Believe he rose again. Believe he's the Savior of the world. Believe. That's it. That's where it starts. But once you have that, don't you dare stop there. You run towards him. I wasted a lot of time in 2020 trying to find life through identity at work. I made the springs way too much of my identity, value system, and who I am. When I'm sitting there preaching to an iPhone and it's the middle of summer, it was destroying me. Why? My sin. My false idolatry. I'm going to repent. I came and I realized in the midst of that, I had a misplaced work where rest is a solution and a gift from God. Some of you, you're running at a pace. Just stop. Repent. Learn. Like I came and I realized in 2020, so much of that activity around my life, I really used to constantly stay busy so I could avoid some of the feelings inside. I don't even like the feeling stuff, but the feelings inside that I don't want to deal with. And when I slowed down and I got quiet, then I had to deal with it and had to realize I have this idolatry of comfort. I'm not promised that by God. I'm promised Christ, period. Accepting that. And now trying, and I'm still on the journey in every way, but now trying to come and find a sense of, you know what the Bible promises me? Contentment, steadfastness, joy. You know you're biblically commanded to enjoy life. That doesn't mean there's not hardship. But how are we doing? I've got so much ground to take. But here's the thing. 2020 helped show me that. I want to start today. I want to keep going. I'm pleading with you. If you're a follower of Christ, come with me. Drag me with you. I'll take you with me. Let me pray. Lord, I thank you for your word and what it does in our lives. I thank you for how I am still absolutely a work in progress, and so is every person in this room. Would you help us to become more like you? Would you help me to know that you're my hope? Like, you're it. I can't place the joy, the well-being in anything other than you. I've done it. I do it all the time, and it always leaves me empty, chasing after the wind. I thank you that you give another direction. I thank you that you stand waiting with open arms. I thank you that because of you, we, by your power, by your strength, we can look back on a year like 2020 and recognize tragedy, weep with those who weep, have cheeks that have turned red because they've been stained with tears, and eventually, by your grace, learned over time, say thank you. Say we trust you. Say, will you help us? And say, we want more of you. May that be our goal. It's in your name we pray. This next part, guys, the band is going to come and they're going to sing part of a song. I'd ask that you please just remain seated. It's a time to anticipate and reflect before we partake in communion. If you're a believer in Jesus, you're invited to do that with us. But stay seated and reflect on the truths that we've talked about. And then my friend Oscar and Maya is going to come up and lead us in communion.